Maybe you're not there yet, but we pray that after today you'll be so in love with the Lord that he'll be the first thing you think about when you get up and the last thing you think about before you go to bed, that he will be the love of your life. And let's use this time just to fall more in love with him as we sing these songs and we hear the scripture today. Let's move closer to him. And we know all who do that. We understand that when we seek him, we will find him. So we just want to seek him this morning. Let's pray, and then let's worship. Father, thank you for this day. God, you have blessed us tremendously. Father, we can't ever say thank you enough. Thank you for life, and for freedom, and for this opportunity. Not just another Sunday, but a day where we can come with our family and friends here and just worship your holy name. Let this be a special day, Lord. Let this be a day that stands out for your glory, Lord. We know, as we taught Wednesday night, we're to pray your kingdom come. So, Father, we are praying that your kingdom comes to earth today, Father, that your will be done. God, we trust you to do great things here and to do what needs to be done in the hearts of men and women. God, give everybody in this place what they need, Father, whether it's uplifting, whatever it is, God, whatever the encouragement, Lord, let them receive what they need from your spirit today as we give you what you deserve. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God,
thank you.
Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. For us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us,
then who can stand against?
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us,
then who can stand against?
Our God is greater, our God is stronger.
I hope he is your God.
Yes.
If he's your God, then he's your King.
Yes.
He can't be your Savior and not your Lord.
Amen.
So when you figure that one out, then it causes you just to fall in line and do what God's called you to do. I can promise you one thing he's called you to do this morning is praise him.
Yes.
No matter where you're at,
yes.
No matter what you've been doing, God always deserves praise. And this morning we want him to be the King of our heart. We want to make him the King of our heart. And we want to declare him the King of our heart this morning.
Thank you.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. You are good, you're good. The King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. Tell him you are good, you're good. The King of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. You are good, you're good.
Never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down.
Never gonna let me down.
good. Oh, tell him you are good. You're good. Oh, you are good. You're good. Tell him again, one more time. You are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good.
Amen. He is good, and we're joining him with the thousands of generations before us who thought the very same thing. If you want to taste and see that the Lord is good today, you can, is what the scripture says. You can be renewed, refreshed, forgiven. You can be everything that God has called you to be when you come into relationship with his Son. So I encourage you today, if you're saved, praise him for being your Savior, and if you're not, then call on him. And he will be your Savior. And it'll give you something to worship him about. Today's a good day. God is here. Don't miss out on the opportunity to meet with him today. You've come here for a reason. And that reason is to find Jesus and let your heart be given to everything that he is. I pray that you'll do that today.
Of a thousand generations, you are worthy, Lord of all. Unto you a slain and risen King, we lift our voice with heaven, singing worthy, Lord of all
through this life we
sing it worthy, Lord of all.
is alive this morning. Do you know that, church? Jesus is alive. He was slain, but now he's risen. He gives you the opportunity to come back from the dead also. Today, put your faith in Jesus. He'll resurrect your sin-sick body. He'll give you a new heart. Well, he deserves the highest praise this morning. Some praise in the house. We worship you, Jesus. We thank you, Father, for all that you've ever done for us. God, and we know this morning's going to be no different, because we're all here to seek you. We're all here to find you. We're all here to gather around the throne this morning and just have a good time in your presence. So, God, we know you're not going to disappoint, Father God. God, we know that if we'll respond to the word that's preached or to the songs that are sung, Father God, that you respond to us, Lord. Lord, I know there's a lot of needs in this house, Father God. But the one thing about it is, God, you're so big that no need is too big. God, I think about David when he looked at that giant. And I don't think he ever saw how big the giant was. I think he always saw how big his God was. So, God, I pray whatever giant standing in front of these people here today, Father God, that they won't look at the giant, but they'll look at the one who created the giant, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and they'll trust you, God, and they'll trust you with everything they have. They'll trust you with their soul. They'll trust you with their life. They'll trust you with their kids. God, it's going to be a good day, and you, it already has been. So, God, I just ask you to answer these prayers. God, do a mighty work in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. We trust you this morning. Amen.
Highest praises,
Lord of all. Come on, give him some praise in the house.
is the King. We lift our voice with heaven, singing worthy, Lord of all.
One more time, give it all you got.
Be enthroned upon the praises of the thousand generations. You are worthy, Lord of all.
Praise. Hallelujah, Jesus. We worship you as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we ask you to let nothing hinder this place today, Father God. We rebuke Satan and all of his forces. Satan, you have to flee. All things that are going to bother this place or hinder this place, Father God, just take them away. Clear our minds, open our minds, clear our hearts, open our hearts, Father God. Let this day be a day of harvest. May it be a day of reconciliation, Father. May this day be a day where we truly meet with you. And we leave here like David saying, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. David wanted to be in your presence, Father. And so do we this morning, God. Send your Holy Spirit in a mighty way. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Shake hands with someone before you sit down. Glad to have you at Missionary Grove today.
Oh, I'm going to try not to get excited today as I don't have a lot of voice left. But I doubt that happens. The best plan of action is get through this one and pray for God to give you more voice for the next one. That's what I'm thinking. So y'all be praying for my voice. When you have four kids, you sometimes lose your voice. Just a warning, any of you thinking about having a bunch of them. They say, happy is the man who has his quiver full of them. Well, I would get you a two-arrow quiver or less. After the jailing of Peter and John in Acts chapter 4, you would have thought they'd have learned their lesson, right? You know, you'd have thought, it's time to be quiet, guys. And usually, that's what people try to do. They try to apply pressure to us that we might be quiet. We might not say what God has called us to say. But like the backwards kingdom that we serve, everything is different in God's kingdom than it is in this kingdom that we stand in now. The pressure actually is supposed to make us speak up more, because the very ones who are putting the pressure on us are the ones that need to be saved. And if we decide we're going to save our skin or our hide or however you want to say it, if we decide we're going to preserve our bodies instead of preserving the gospel, we're going to have a rude awakening one day. I mean, we've either got to be all in or all out. There's no in between. It's saved or lost. It's all in or all out. You can't ride the fence. You can't do what you want to do when you're not here and do what God wants you to do here. This ain't how this works. It is either you are or you are not. And the very people who don't like us are the ones who need us to be the ours, that we are these people that we claim to be. This is the message, the only message, and that's what I told you about last week. We're drawing a line in the sand with the rest of the world. We're saying Jesus is the only way. That's going to bring conflict. That's going to bring trouble and trial and tribulation, but we have to preach Jesus is the only way. We have to preach only by his name can you be forgiven and receive life eternal. We have to stand strong in the face of adversity, and our message has to be as clear as the message in Acts chapter 4 and verse number 12. The verse reads like this: there is salvation in no one else. Is that plain enough? I like plain speech. Don't make me try to figure out what you're trying to say to me. Just say what you're saying, okay? That's what I have to do a lot of time with church members. When they're talking to me, I have to say, Lord, what are they really saying? Or with women. Lord, what's my wife really saying? I'm not understanding. Lord, please help me so I don't get in trouble. Clear speech. God has given no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. If you can get it any clearer than that, then I'd like to hear it. It is very simple. It's a bold statement, but it has to be said. This is our message. It has to be shouted from the rooftops. Jesus saves, and Jesus alone, and we're going to ask Him to do that very thing this morning. Save the lost and touch us who are saved, that we would not be afraid to preach this gospel. Father, thank You for the gospel. Lord, we know that it is to those who are perishing foolishness, but for those who to believe, salvation. We know that we are not to be ashamed. Paul wrote and said, do not be ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. We know over and over in Scripture, people stood in the face of adversity. They were thrown into fires. They were thrown into lions' dens. They were put up on crosses. They were beaten, and it kept on happening, God, all throughout the ages. And right now, in other places besides here, God, there are many people suffering because they will not back down from the name of Jesus. Father, help us see the name of Jesus as the most important thing in this life, God. Not our bodies, not our health, not our jobs. Let us put nothing in front of proclaiming the name of Jesus. We have to have that name proclaimed because He is the only way of salvation. God, we cannot be quiet. Help us to be strong and bold and lift up our voices like a trumpet and cry aloud, Father God. Help us to make it plain. God, let this message be plain, so plain a child can understand it, Father God. For we have to come in the faith of a child, just believing what You say. Lord, let me not mess that up this morning, God. Preach through me. Preach in me, God. Preach, God, just help my throat. Father God, help everything in this room to be like You, God. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. May this day Your kingdom come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. First off, in verses number 5 through 7, we see that the leaders have some questions. So before this, they have healed a man who was crippled from birth. Now they have been arrested. And when they got arrested, they sat in jail overnight. And it says the next day in verse 5, the council of all the rulers, elders, teachers of religious law met in Jerusalem. So everybody that is supposed to be somebody in the religious system is now going against those who are ushering in the gospel of Jesus Christ. It said in verse 6, Annas the high priest was there, along with Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and other relatives of the high priest. Now, this relatives made up the Jewish high council. And if you remember, maybe you remember by the scripture, or maybe you remember by the Passion of the Christ. You could see this a lot of different places down through the years. But you remember the names Annas and Caiaphas. They played specific, significant roles in the murdering of Jesus, in the killing of Jesus. So the very ones who have killed Jesus in protection of their money, in protection of their Jerusalem and the protection of their culture, the very ones that have killed Jesus are now trying to stamp out His followers. And it kept on continuing that way, and it still is today. Those who would kill Jesus are going to try to kill us. But they ask a very good question in verse number 7. And maybe that's you this morning. You're wanting to ask something of the Lord or try to figure something out. It's very important to ask the right question. Verse number 7. They brought in the two disciples and demanded, by what power or in whose name have you done this? I titled this sermon, The Name Above All Names. What did you do to this man? Where did you get the power? And who did that power come from? Whose name are you doing this in? If they would have said maybe Yahweh, if they would have said anybody, maybe Moses or Abraham or anybody else, they might not have been in this position. But they're very, very insistent people. They are going to tell the truth no matter what happened. You know, we need some people like that in this church and in this community. People who tell the truth, not caring what other people think about the truth. I'm tired of a yellow-bellied, yellow-backed church that is afraid to walk out in the waters and stir them a little bit for the cause of Christ. I'm tired of cowering down and backing down. Listen here, if they want to blow me up, that's fine. Whatever they want to do, that's fine. I'm going to go to Walmart and tell about Jesus. I'm going to go home. I'm going to do everything I can do to tell the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm not going to live my life in fear. The scripture teaches that I am to fear no man, but to fear God, who's the power of life and death in His hand. If you fear ISIS or fear anybody, then you don't have enough trust in God. Listen, these leaders are coming against them, and there is the opportunity. If they murder Jesus, then they could probably get these two killed also. If they could do it to the Son of God, Peter and John have nothing but the Lord on their side. But I like that because verse 8 says, Peter was full of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If you're going to preach the gospel of Christ, you better make sure you're full of the Holy Spirit. If you're going to walk boldly in this world, you better make sure you're full of the Holy Spirit. You better make sure the steps you're walking in are the steps God wants you to walk in, and that you're spending time by yourself and loving on the Lord loving on you and filling you full, praying as we taught Wednesday night, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We better make sure that we are right. If you want to fight a battle, a soldier doesn't go into battle without his gun, without his protective gear, without his helmet. He doesn't go into battle without his bullets. He prepares. And he is ready for when the fight comes to him. He takes the fight to them. Christian, it's time for us to prepare to fight the world that is outside of here. But listen, our weapons are not carnal. Our weapons are spiritual. The pulling down of strongholds. We've got to understand the truth of the matter is we're fighting a foe that we cannot see, but he has materialized the church. He has manifested himself. Listen, I bet the devil in America, I bet his forces have manifested themselves more than the Spirit of God. We wouldn't be in the shape we are. If the Spirit of God was manifesting Himself in every church upon every people all the time, there wouldn't be no room for anybody in any church around. Listen to me. The devil's going to try to stop you from doing what you're doing. He's going to try to kill you, and he's going to question you. But when he says things like, in whose name have you done this? You need to answer like Peter did. He said, then Peter, full of the Holy Spirit. It means under the influence. I don't know if you've ever been under the influence of something else, okay? But when you're under the influence of something else, it takes over your mind. It takes over your body. It puts you in a place where that influence, whatever that was at that time, drugs or alcohol or a mesmerizing woman or something, you are not in your right mind. I'm telling you, when the Holy Spirit fully takes you over, then He operates in your mind and your body and gives you the ability to do things you never would have the ability to do if you were just walking in your own flesh. Peter's standing up in a bunch of people who killed Jesus, and this is what he says. Rulers and elders of our people, verse 9, are we being questioned today because we've done a good deed for a crippled man? I mean, didn't they do something good?
Amen.
I mean, if people start jumping out of wheelchairs in here, I'm fixing to start running, you know what I'm saying? Some of y'all couldn't get excited if the Lord was standing in here right now. But if people start getting up out of wheelchairs, you'd make a move. I guarantee it. You know, like this is like good times here. God is jumping people up off the ground who's never walked in their life. I mean, and now they're being questioned for the good they're doing. And then he says, do you want to know how he was healed? I think this was an escape question right here. I think Peter was like saying, do you really want to know what I'm fixing to tell you? Because you're not going to like it. You didn't like Jesus. You killed him. You didn't like what Jesus did. You're not going to like what I'm fixing to say. You're not going to enjoy what's fixing to come out of my mouth. I know what you believe, Peter's saying. Do you really want to know? I think he's giving them an escape clause here. Are you going to turn me loose or do you want to hear it? Do you really want to know? I mean, are you going to like what I'm fixing to say? And Peter is very, very plain in verse 10. And I like plain speech. I've already said this. Let me clearly state.
Amen.
Let me not jumble this up. That's what I prayed to God when I wrote this was, Father, don't let me mess this up, God. Keep my tongue and my mouth working right. Keep my brain, everything that I've got, keep it focused upon you and making sure everybody understands the truth of what's being said here. Verse 10, let me clearly state to all of you and to all the people of Israel that he was healed by the powerful name of Jesus the Christ of Nazareth. Now, when he says words like that, it's kind of a jab at them. His name was Jesus. Christ is the son that's come to save. He puts a title on the back of it, and then he tells them where he's from. He's from right down the road here. Jesus, the Savior of the world, your next door neighbor. Like, they don't like to hear this thing, because everybody that's talking to him right now, the majority of them are Sadducees, and they do not believe that somebody can come back from the dead. He said, the man, in verse number 10, that you crucified, but whom God has raised from the dead. Talk about ticking somebody off from the very beginning. They are mad right now. He is throwing Jesus in their face. He's telling them he's the Savior. He's telling them he's your neighbor, and that he come back from the dead and came back into life, and they don't even believe half of what he is saying. So if that wasn't enough, just to kind of poke them in the eye, let me be clear. He's saying, let me be frank with you. Let me tell you what's really going on here. If that wasn't enough, then in verse 11, he starts quoting Old Testament scripture. Now, these guys are going to know Old Testament scripture. Like the good Pharisees were able to quote the first five books of the scripture, the Pentateuch. They were by heart, by mind. I'm saying they knew the Word of God. They knew the Psalms. They knew Isaiah. They knew when he said the stone. He said, you have killed, but God has raised up Jesus, the one the Scripture says, the stone that you builders rejected has now become the chief cornerstone. Amen. The cornerstone. You think about that for just a minute. The one that you were trying to kill to build your kingdom has now been resurrected, and he's building his own. The one that you tried to push out of the way, the one that you tried to get rid of, the one you said was a crazy man that was messing up your pocketbook, you tried to remove him, but God would not let you. He would not let you. Why is the name of Jesus the name above all names? He says the name of Jesus, there's salvation in no one else, and God has given no other name. Well, I thought about that for a little while, and I thought, where could I go in the Scripture? Because we want to answer every question we get by the Scripture, not by human reasoning. Human reasoning can mess you up. Philippians chapter 2. And I think about what Paul said here in verse number 6. He said, though he was God. The first verse, though he was God. He did not think equality with God as something to cling to. See, Jesus wasn't just a man. He was also the God-man. If you read the book of Matthew, he was referred to that many, many times. He is the man that God sent, who was the Son, who was the picture of who God had embodied in the flesh. He was not just another man. He gave up his divine privileges. Can you imagine what Jesus gave up in heaven to come to earth? Listen, if I'd have been Jesus, I'd been like, they can handle it. I'm staying here. Let's figure this out, something else. Can you imagine what he left? Can you imagine leaving your father you've never been away from in your life? Can you imagine going to a place where you're going to cut your arm and you're going to stump your toe? People are going to hate you. People are going to revile you. You're going to have to do all these things, but nobody's going to accept you. Jesus knew fully well what he was going into. Nothing, whatever is taking you by surprise, nothing has ever taken our Father by surprise, okay? So he's fully in control, and he knows, listen, I'm fixing to go down here to a mess. But he says instead he gave up those divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself to the obedience of God and died a criminal's death. Therefore, because of those verses before that, because he gave up his divine privilege, because he did not think equality something to hold on to, because he put himself in the position of a slave, because he was born a human being, because he came in human form, because he was humble and obedient and died a criminal's death. Because of that, God has elevated him to the highest honor and gave him the name that is above all other names in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. I skip verse 10. And that every knee will bow also. I think about this name. Jesus got the name of Jesus. The reason that name is exalted, the reason Peter is saying there is no other name, because Jesus was willing to be obedient and be humble and do what the Father said. Therefore, Father elevated him. Amen. Now, a word for you. If we want to be humble, we can be elevated. If we want to be obedient, we can be elevated. But if we don't want to be humble and obedient, then we're going to stay down, okay? You know what? God's going to use a church like this to move mountains. You know he's going to do that? He's going to do it through humble and obedient people. Not through people say, look at us, but through people that say, look at him. Not, who cares if you know my name? What about Jesus' name? Who cares if you know everybody in this place? Who cares what anybody's saying about us? We want to lift up Jesus and Jesus alone. He was the one the Father lifted up. Now we are going to lift up. And the thing about these verses in Philippians chapter 2 is it says, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. See, Jesus has to be your Savior and your Lord. He just doesn't save you from hell, but he saves you from your sin and he saves you unto God. He gives you the Spirit of God. He gives you a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. He saves you completely. Every part of you. You bow to him now. The problem with bowing later is there might not be a later. You know, I put things off. I've got a little list on the counter. It's been there about a year. I didn't write the list. I ain't going to tell you who did. But now there's three lines marked off. I'm doing better. Three lines. I think she did two of them. But, you know, like the list is short. I'm trying to get it done, but what if I don't get it done? It's not a big deal. I mean, we'll get it done sometime. If you told a man to do something, you don't have to tell him every week. He'll get to it 6 months or so down the road. But what if you mess this one up? Like, what if this big list called the Scripture is telling you to do something, and you say, I'll do it tomorrow. I've got a good life to live. I'll just when I feel better, really don't. It's maybe not this time. I want to do it when my kids are here. You know, we got all these excuses in life. And if I don't get the outside of the house pressure washed and I die, it's not a big deal, okay? But if you don't have Jesus and you die, you've missed it all. Like, there's no turning around and coming back and getting Jesus and going back to heaven. Once you reach your eternity, you are there for eternity. So I'm telling you to preach the name of Jesus, the name above all names, because everybody that's hearing you, if they die today without Jesus, they go to hell. Hell never ends. Mark says, where the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. There is nothing. The rich man and Lazarus is not a parable. It is a true story about two men. And the rich man died and went to hell. And Lazarus died and went to Abraham's bosom. And the rich man is sitting in hell saying, hey, why don't you go tell my brothers, you know? Why don't you go tell my family this place is terrible? There was a divide between him and the rest of them. And they said, why would we do that? If they hadn't listened to the prophets, they hadn't listened to nobody. He said, well, maybe if I went back. They said, no, they won't listen to Jesus. They won't listen to anybody, not even one back from the dead. He said, please, please, just dip your finger in some water and cool my tormented tongue. And there was never an answer. It was he was in hell and they weren't, and he was going to stay there and suffer and they weren't. I mean, there's no other way to look at it. If there's no afterlife, this is a waste of our time. You know, if there's not a heaven or hell, what's the point in getting saved? If there's not a heaven or hell, what's the point of taking the only name of Jesus into this community? If we're all just going to have a big party after we die, forget it. Let's start the party now. You know what I'm saying? It's very serious, though. It's very, very, very serious. I'm glad that God, for 18 years of my life, was telling me the truth, and even though I was rejecting it, he gave me multiple opportunities to come to him in faith by repentance. I want you to know that you might have been given a lot of opportunities in life, but this could be the last one. I don't know if life is like a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. We're all closer to death than we understand. There won't be no arguing with God when you get there. In fact, from what I see in the scripture, the rich man and Lazarus, is where you open your eyes is where you're going to be. You ain't going to stand up there and he's going to say, you did this much good and this much bad. See, judgments that settled at the moment of death. If you're not in Christ, you go to hell. If you are in Christ, you go to the Father. There won't be no pleading your case. The only one that can plead your case is Jesus through his shed blood. And unless you're in him, you're out. Listen, you cannot take a chance on waiting till you get there. You can't take a chance on this service ending. Even right now, if you know God's calling upon your heart, pulling you to turn from your sin and turn towards him, you have to do that because there is no one else. There is no one else you can be saved by. And then verse number 12, if that wasn't enough, he said, God has given him no other name. You think about that for just a minute. Jesus said that he was the way, but his Father is the one who gave him the name that is the way. God has given him all authority. See, and if we're looking at Jews when he's preaching, he's looking at them who believe in the same God that Jesus came from, but they don't believe Jesus is the Messiah. So he's looking at a bunch of people and he's saying, your God gave him this name. Can you imagine how infuriated these people are? Everybody says that we worship the same God, but the God I worship says that Jesus is the only way. My God is not double-minded. He hasn't made multiple plans of salvation. He made sure we all know that it is only through Jesus Christ and nobody else can save us. There is no other name. Let me tell you this also. You can't save yourself. If there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby you must be saved, Matthew can't save Matthew. You listening to me? Matthew can't save Matthew. Only Jesus can save Matthew. You can't save yourself. You can't work to get there. You cannot give enough money to the poor to cleanse yourself from all your sin. The baptismal waters are just water. That's the same thing you brush your teeth with. That's the same water that's in the toilet. You understand that? Like, the only way you're going to get clean is you take a bar of soap in there and take a bath, okay? You get clean in your heart by faith you believe. By faith you believe. Romans chapter 10, and I'm trying to wind this thing down. Romans chapter 10, and I'm going to read to you several verses in Romans chapter 10. But I want you to understand truly what salvation is. Verse number 10 says, dear brothers and sisters, the longing of my heart and my prayer is for God, is for the people of Israel to be saved. So Paul loved the people of Israel. In fact, at one time he said, I wish I could go to hell for them and they could go to heaven instead of me. He wished he was accursed for any. Listen, if anybody loves you enough to take your punishment for them, you ought to love them. Amen. Jesus took your punishment. Think about that. Verse 2, I know the enthusiasm they have for God, but it is misdirected zeal. Not that these people weren't passionate, but they were passionate about the wrong things. For they don't understand God's way of making people right with himself. Refusing to accept God's way and clinging to their own way to get right with God by trying to keep the law. For Christ has already accomplished the purpose for which the law was given. As a result, all those who believe in him are made right with God. The law couldn't be kept. For by grace are you saved through faith. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. How many times do we have to read the Bible when we finally just rest in Christ in faith and do what he's telling us to do? And the reason we do what he's telling us to do is because we want to be obedient. And listen, I am not trying to make it to heaven. I'm as good as already there because I'm in Christ, okay? Listen, I'm not doing all this hoping that the scales will balance out on my side. I am there already, positionally seated in the sun. And when God looks down and sees me, he sees the blood of his son that has covered me and forgiven me. I'm not trying to make it. I've already made it, okay? The law, doing good things, all these things. You have to adhere to all the commands of the law. If you were going to work your way to heaven, you would have to find the law of God because it is the perfect law of God. You would have to look at it and you would have to never break any of those laws ever in your life from the time of birth to your time of death. Has anybody ever been able to do that? How many of you ever told a lie? Some of you ain't raising your hand, but you was a kid one time. And I know your mama said, you do that? You said, no, I didn't do it. No. That's a lie, okay? Condemned. Anybody ever stole anything? Anybody cheated on something? Anybody ever looked at a woman with lust? Don't say yes if your wife's, guys. Listen, we've all broke the law of God. So here I am going to the kingdom, and it's not by my good works. When you get to the kingdom, you're praising God for all that God has done. And he says the message is very close. It's in your lips and your heart. Verse number 8. And he said, and that message is the very message about faith that we preach. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Now listen, Jesus is Lord. Every knee will bow. Every tongue will confess. One day when this is all over and he makes the world his footstool, everybody's going to bow their knee. But you're given the opportunity to make him your Lord now. When you say Jesus is Lord, that is a statement that is true whether you accept it or not. But there's got to be a point in your life where you say, Jesus is my Lord. Because this is the call to every man. But when you get saved, it's the call to you. It's personal. Hear me. I believe, I confess that Jesus is my Lord. And he said, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. If you believe the truth of what Jesus Christ came to do, that he came to earth, that he was beat to pieces. He was put on a cross. He was hung there. He died. He did it for your sin. He went into the grave. He come back. If you believe that is true in your heart and you confess your allegiance to Jesus, then he will save you. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God, and it is by confessing with your mouth that you are saved. I believe Christ. Jesus. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verses 3 and 4, Paul said the gospel is that he died, he was buried, and that he was resurrected. I believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you are the Lord of my life. Listen, it's not that hard. We complicate it with all of these things. We've made it so hard that people can't hardly get saved. Listen to me. You believe, then put them beliefs into action and say, Jesus Christ is the Lord of my life. Be full of the Holy Spirit of God and walk in the salvation that God has granted you through his Son. He said, anyone who trusts in him will never be disgraced. Jew or Gentile are the same in respect. They have the same Lord who gives generously to all who call him. He gives you everything you need for life and godliness when you call upon his name. And he says these words, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.
Amen. Amen.
If you've believed the gospel and you've confessed to the Lord your allegiance to him, hear me. If you've done that, you're saved. For whoever calls on him is saved.
Yes.
You listening to me?
Yes.
This is not rocket science. In fact, if it had been, I'd still be lost. He made it so simple I could understand it. Confess your allegiance. Believe in your heart. He said, but how will they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? And how can they believe in him if they've never heard about him? How can they hear about him unless somebody tells them? Did you hear that? How's everybody else going to figure this out unless you tell them? You got to tell them. Amen. It's your job. Yes. If you've been saved, it's your job to tell somebody about Jesus. It's my job too. Yes. I'm not just putting it on you. Everybody that's ever been saved, this is their job. It says that the scripture says, how beautiful are the feet of the messengers who bring good news. That verse didn't pertain to me. I have ugly feet. But what he's saying is how beautiful it is when people are obedient to the word of God. See, the bad thing about it is you think I'm the preacher and you're the congregation. The truth of the matter is we're all preachers. We're priesthood of believers. All called to do the same thing. Lift up the name of Jesus. Lift up the name of Jesus. And when you lift up Jesus, it draws sinners to himself. When you say there's no other name, when you preach that, because the Holy Spirit comes from heaven and he tells them in their soul, he's right, she's right. There is no other name. There's no other name. All heads bowed and all eyes closed. I want to ask you a question right quick. Here's the question. Have you truly been saved? Now, the question here also is this. Are you trusting in anyone? Are you trusting in anyone for your salvation except the person of Jesus Christ? Is there anything else that you're trusting? If you're trusting in anything else for your salvation, you cancel out grace. There is no salvation in any other name. So are you, you've got to search your soul right now. You've got to search your, are you trusting in anybody besides Jesus? That includes yourself. Are you trusting in yourself more than Christ? Are you trusting in your business more than Christ? Are you trusting in your money more than Christ? Are you trusting in your wife or your husband more than Christ? Is he alone the object of your faith and your salvation? Have you truly confessed him as your Lord? Have you truly said to him and before the people, Jesus Christ is the Lord of my life? I believe, have you really given yourself to the person of Jesus Christ? Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pray. We're going to have altar call for a few minutes because you have to respond to Christ if he has talked to you this morning. So I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to open this altar up. There's going to be men and women sitting on the very front middle row. If you need to get this right, you need to come to Jesus. You come to forward this morning. Father, in Jesus' name, we pray your help to everyone who needs it in this place, God. In Jesus' name, the name that is above all names, the name that we will all bow to, but now we can bow to Jesus. In that name, we ask you, Father, to let the sinner step forward, God. Let them not be ashamed of the gospel. Father, let people be saved in this place and let your word change them in your Holy Spirit, God. We trust you to do these things right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All heads bowed and all eyes closed. You come this morning. If you want to come pray for a lost person, if you want to come pray for boldness like Peter and John, you come. If you're having trouble giving the gospel, you pray for God to give you clarity in that. But the altar is open. You need to come and get what you need from the person of Jesus Christ. Some have already come. Don't be ashamed. Don't be afraid. We are on your side. The only one against you is the devil, and we don't even care about him here. We love Jesus, and we're going to do what Jesus wants us to do. I'm asking you, turn your life over to Jesus. Turn your life over to Jesus. You don't have to walk the road alone. You just walk up this pew. We'll help you. Walk up these aisles. We'll help you. We're here to help you. Is there anybody in here right now? Just raise their hand and say, preacher, I'm not saved. I'm confused. I don't know any of those things. Does anybody raise their hand? Let me pray for you right now. Anybody say, I don't know if I'm saved or not. Anybody that would raise their hand and say that, just be honest with yourself, honest with me. So I can pray for you. Anybody that say, I'm not saved this morning. Anybody? Amen. We're all being truthful. It looks like everybody's saved in this place. I thank the Lord for that. So here's what I'm going to pray over you while these still pray in the altar. I'm going to pray that God will give you such a passion for the lost, a soul for the lost, a heart for the lost in His work, that you will not be able to stop talking about the name that is above all.